Guys, it's been a great, great week. And the attendance has been wonderful, the workshops, the seminars. I just want to give a thanks again to the WEC leaders. So let's give it up for them. They've done a phenomenal job all week. They've put so many hours and hours of prayer and work into this. It's been a great, they've done a great job. My name is Michael Ortiz. I am, I guess maybe the newest faculty member. Is that right? And I'll be teaching in the World Missions Intercultural Studies Department. Also, I will be serving as director of what's now called DTS en Español. So it's a good day to hear some Spanish songs, right? But we will be talking more about that later on. I wanted to talk about Matt Mikalatos. Mac is a father. He's a husband. He's a Christian. That's a good thing, right? He's a Christ follower. He's a speaker. He's a disciple maker. He's an evangelist. I'd love to hear his stories about sharing the gospel with his atheist friends. Maybe he'll tell us how it went yesterday over lunch today. But he's also an author, and he's authored 6 different books. And his books range in a varied range of genres. And one of them is called, I never heard this before, it's called Comedy Theology. Is that true?
It's true.
It is true. And he wrote a book a few years ago called, Imaginary Jesus. I'm sorry, Imaginary Jesus, there it is. But then it was updated. It was later called My Imaginary. You want to hold it up higher? There you go. And Relevant Magazine hailed this book as Monty Python meets who? C.S. Lewis. So, and he's also written a number of other books, as I mentioned. His most recent book was Sky Lantern. And if you guys were not here yesterday, I highly encourage you to hear his podcast from yesterday. He did a great job of laying down the foundation and the story behind that book. And not just the story, but how God uses incredible, unpredictable circumstances to lead people closer to the Lord. Matt's also worked for Crew. He's been on staff there for 16 years. He's worked as a missionary in countries like Spain, Croatia, Turkey, Asia. He's also married to Krista. Krista's right there. Will Krista stand up for a second? You want to just wait? Right. And they both, Krista has been a teacher in a college and seminary, including Western Seminary. They have 3 children. They live in Portland, Oregon. And I know they're heading back tomorrow. The other night I was walking to Mitchell with them, and Krista and I were just sharing a little bit about our background and our stories a little bit, and we talked about our kids for a second, and she mentioned that they have these 3 wonderful daughters back home, and she was looking at her cell phone, and the gist of the conversation was, I want to stay in touch with them during this week because I know I'm going to be missing them, they'll be missing me and their dad this week. So on behalf of Dallas Seminary and on behalf of the WEC team and leadership, I want to say thank you for being here this week and serving us so well. And when you get back to Portland tomorrow, thank your 3 little girls for sending their mom and dad to us this week. Okay, so welcome, Matt Mikalatos.
So let me tell you a story now. Jesus went to the strangest parties. He'd be in a group of people where it's the kind of place that you'd walk in and it would smell of marijuana smoke, spilled beer, people jammed in together. You could hear the throbbing bass of the house band. And he'd be sitting there with people that would shock you, that would surprise you. And there were some people looking for him. They had just come from church, the religious people, the people doing their best to follow God. And they'd walk in with their dress shoes and their nice jeans and their collared shirt and their little blazer. And there'd be the women. They'd just come from church too, so they're wearing floral dresses, right? And they all walk in, and they, like, they've walked into a haunted house. What is this place? Terrified of the people, terrified of the place. And they look and they see him and they say, "What are you doing here? Why would you be among these people? These are the people that when we drive by, we lock the car doors. We should just brick off this part of town. Let's make a wall. There'll be a small door in it, but let's make a wall. And why are you here? And Jesus turned to them and he said, because of Andy Johnson. This is in Luke 15. because of Andy Johnson, he says. Andy Johnson was a second grade school teacher in Los Angeles, and he worked in a district where the poverty of the children made a knot in his stomach to see these kids, these poor kids with nothing. And he thought to himself, is there some way to give them one bright memory of second grade, one sort of technicolor moment that they would look back on and say, that was amazing. That was beautiful. And so he decided that somehow he was going to figure out a way to take them to the best zoo in the world, the San Diego Zoo. And he went around and begged the administration. He went and raised money. He went and asked people who had cash to put money behind it so that finally he was able to get a school district bus and parent volunteers and permission from all the parents to take not just his second graders, but all the second graders in the school on a field trip to the San Diego Zoo, 100 kids. And so they get in the bus and they drive down to San Diego, and everyone is so excited. The kids can barely contain themselves. And so he did what you always do on a field trip, is there was one parent for every 10 kids. He put them all together and he said, okay, we're all going to stick together. No one's going anywhere else. We're all together, we're going to go to the places. And the kids were like, penguins, are we going to the penguins first? He said, no, not the way it's built out. We'll get to the penguins after lunch. Don't worry. And yes, penguins are amazing, but that's not where we're starting. We're going to go to the elephants, and we're going to you know, see the rhinoceros. We're going to do all these things. The kids were just bouncing off the walls. And what does he do? He's in charge of these kids. So all day long, he's doing what he's been teaching them to do, which is count to 100. So he's 96, 97, 98, 99, 100, all day. 96, 97, 98, 99, 100. This is what he does. It's like a mantra. And all day long, he's doing this. And as they're moving toward lunch, he starts to count the kids. 96, 97, 98, 99. Oh, I miscounted. 96, 97, 98, 99. Oh, no. Oh, no. And he quickly makes the zero call, which is what tells the children to be quiet. And he has them gather in their groups with their parents. And he has everyone count 96, 97, 98, 99. And there's one kid missing. His name's Roger Hom. He's a good kid, but he's curious, and he does often wander. So what does he do? Well, he's a teacher. And he knows that 99 out of 100 is an A. So they just leave that kid at the zoo. Well, no, of course not. That's crazy. He says to the parents, build a protective circle around these children. And if they cross the line, politely tell them to return because this is public school and that's all we have authority to do. And he goes out into the zoo to find Roger. And he's running around asking passersby, asking the employees, asking anyone he sees, have you seen Roger? He's in second grade. He's about this tall. And no one's seen him. And he's racing around the zoo trying to find him. And he can't find him anywhere. And he's so panicked. He has to find this kid. And when finally he sees him, you know where he finds him. The penguins. He wraps him up in his arms in this hug that makes Roger feel confused and happy. That his teacher is so thrilled to see him. And he takes him, and there's no way this kid's getting away. He puts him on his shoulders. And he walks back to where everyone was waiting, having lunch. And when the adults see him coming in with Roger, a cheer rises up from the group. And Jesus turns to the religious people, and he says, in the same way, there's more cheering in heaven for the one who was lost and brought back home than over the 99 who stayed where they should have. Now, of course, they don't completely understand at this point, and he goes on to tell them some other stories. But for now, let's pray, and then we'll look at another story. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the way that you have revealed your love for humanity in such beautiful ways, beautiful stories in Scripture, beautiful words, poems, essays, letters, that you've used every way of communication to tell us how much you love us. That you've drawn us to yourself, that you sent your Son, that you adopted us as children, that you lavished us with love and sent us to the world, all because of your love for the cosmos, the people of the earth. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. We pray as we look at this story today that you would open our eyes to the people around us and that you would give us courage to realize that missions matters now in the same way that a love letter matters now and that it must be delivered. In your name, amen. Now, the first morning, we talked about the coming of fire. You can't hide fire when it comes. And yesterday, we talked about the presence of Jesus in the midst of tragedy. How do we talk about this in a way that shows the love of God? Today, we're going to talk about something that was happening in the early church, but we're really going to be talking in some sense about water. And in the early church, everything is changing. That strange things are happening. There's confusion and violence and people being arrested. In the midst of this, there's one anchor, one person who shows up over and over in the story who keeps the church on the path that God intends them to be on, and that is the Holy Spirit. Now, I want you to imagine this. Imagine that God sends an angel to you. Now, not all of us have seen angels, but just imagine for a moment, you're watching Netflix on your computer when suddenly it catches on fire and is not consumed. And you are confused by this great sight and think, perhaps I have fallen asleep watching Netflix again. But no, you are awake. And an angel comes to you and says, I want you to go to the road, the desert road outside of Dallas, and wait there. Now, if you're like me, I would say, yes, Lord, give me more information. What shall I do upon this desert road? I do not like not knowing what it is you're asking. He says, just go to the road. An angel tells you, go to the road. And when you get out to the road, assuming, unlike me, you're the type of person who actually follows through on what God says to you when you don't know what he's talking about, you get out to the road. And as you're standing there on the road, you see a caravan. You see the police motorcycles coming, the black SUVs, and a stretch limo with little flags on the front, red, white, and green flags. And you see the police with their pistols strapped onto their legs and their mirrored shades. And then God says to you, run over close to that limousine. Now, it's moving pretty fast. It is the highway, after all. But you manage to run up alongside the caravan, up alongside this limousine. And of course, the caravan stops, it pulls over, and the police are holding you back and telling you to move along. But through the open window of the limousine, you see someone with their iPad out, and it looks like maybe they've got a Bible app open on there. And you shout as the police are pushing you back, do you understand what you're reading? And the person inside says, let him come over here. Let her come over to me. So you walk over, you get patted down and sent up to the door. And when you step inside the limousine, it's cool and it's comfortable. And the person across from you is like someone you've never seen. His fingers are long, like a pianist, and he's tall and very thin. And his suit, it's like it was painted onto him. He's obviously a person with a great deal of money. And when he shakes your hand, his skin is soft, feminine even. And his voice too. And he's wearing a light perfume. And you say to him again, do you understand what you're reading? And he says with some bitterness in his voice, how could I understand when no one will explain it to me? And beginning in the very text he's reading, Isaiah 53, you began to explain to him the good news, the beautiful story of Jesus. Now, I think by now many of you have probably guessed what story I'm getting at. It's the story of creation. Just kidding. Just kidding. Okay, let's look at Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." So he started out, and on his way, he met an Ethiopian eunuch, an important official in charge of all the treasury of the Kandaki, the Candace, which means the queen of the Ethiopians. At this time, Ethiopia was a matriarchy and had been for multiple generations. Some of the most powerful women in the world at this time were in Ethiopia. This man, the eunuch, had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and on his way home was sitting in his chariot reading the book of Isaiah, the prophet. And the Spirit told Philip, "Go to that chariot and stay near it." Philip ran up to the chariot and heard the man reading Isaiah and asked him, "Do you understand what you're reading?" "How can I," he said, "unless someone explains it to me?" So he invited Philip to come and sit with him. And then it shares the passage the eunuch was reading, which we will get to. Here's an interesting thing. The Ethiopian eunuch, clearly powerful, a powerful man, had been given permission by his ruler, his owner, to go and worship for some reason. Somehow he had come to know the God of Jerusalem, and he had come to worship. And here's the thing you would have known immediately. We don't know a lot about castration today. It's not as common as it was at this time in the world, but most likely, knowing what was going on in Ethiopia at the time and what was typical, most likely this young man had been a slave. And what they would do with slaves is they would take them from their families, usually around the age of 10, and they would castrate them. The reason they castrated them, and we won't go into the details of how exactly they did it, we have a pretty decent idea. The reason they did that was so that they would sever all family relationships and all potential for a future family, so that you'd have no desire for political power to pass on to your children. You'd have no need to overthrow the government or to try and take the throne. And you could instead focus yourself on your new family, which was the royal family, and could take care of the queen and do the things that she asked. Now, this was a man who was clearly intelligent. He ran the treasury. It was a man who had a great deal of influence and was trusted by the queen. What's interesting is, obviously, being castrated, he's unable to have children. That's part of the point. Also, when castrated, what tells a male's bones to stop growing is the onset of testosterone, which would never happen for a eunuch. So often they were abnormally tall for whatever culture they were in. Their long bones particularly don't stop growing, so their thigh bones, some of their arm bones. Without the onset of testosterone, their skin would be soft, closer to what we would expect a woman's skin to be like. They would never experience male pattern baldness, which is one of the few positive things about being castrated, gentlemen. They could not grow a beard or facial hair. So these are people who could be recognized on the street. You would know without doubt, oh, that guy's a eunuch. They didn't have to wear special clothes or anything. You could tell by glancing at them. Because as people at that time would have said, they would have used a word similar to effeminate. They did not look masculine, and they were tall. And this man, in addition, was a foreigner. He was Ethiopian. So everything about him, who he was in that sense, was very clear from a simple glance, a simple glance. And here's what happened. When he went to Jerusalem, he went to worship. Now, we know already that as even a God-fearing Gentile, he can go no further than the court of the Gentiles. He can't enter completely into the community of faith. Now, should he choose to be circumcised, he could convert to Judaism, but he could not be circumcised because he was emasculated. So he's physically incapable of following the necessary rituals to become completely Jewish. He could never go any further than the court of the Gentiles. And the Jews were right, scripturally correct to put this limitation on him. Deuteronomy 23:1 says, "No one who's been emasculated by cutting or crushing may enter the assembly of the Lord." That's what scripture says. And so in addition to this, I would just mention this. Josephus tells us, you know, ancient historian Josephus, tells us that the Jews, in addition, treated those who had been emasculated with particular contempt. In fact, there are writings, contemporary writings from about this time, that say if you meet a eunuch, what has happened is that their body has been caused to meet an internal spiritual condition in which they have effeminate spirits. And so someone who has been emasculated, whether it's their fault or not, you should treat them as a child killer because they've cut off any chance of having children. So the experience of the Ethiopian eunuch, a God-fearing man, fearing the God of Israel, when he came to the temple to worship, was that the people of God, the Jews at that time, looked at him and saw a foreigner, a eunuch, a feminine man, a child killer. And when he says to Philip, "How can I understand unless someone explains it to me?" Probably what he literally means is, no one will speak to me. I have questions about this God who I worship, but I'm not allowed to interact with the people of God. So, he's been to Jerusalem to worship, at best treated as a God-fearer, not a Jew. And the best he can hope for in the temple is to be allowed into the court of the Gentiles, not to worship with the rest of the community. He can't fully enter. He's well off. He can buy his own scroll, which in those days was uncommon. So he has the scriptures, but he's not good enough. He's disqualified from the community of faith because he's a foreigner, because he's castrated, because he's effeminate, because he's unable to have children. How can I understand unless someone explains it to me? But the people of God refuse to speak to him. Are there people you can think of today who the people of God would refuse to speak to? That we would look the other way, that we would tell them to move along, people with certain kinds of sin in their lives, people who frighten us. Who can you think of who might just feel, they might just assume that the community of faith is not interested in speaking to them? Oh, I'm asking you, tell the person next to you, can you think of some people? Go ahead. Okay, let's hear a few. Just shout it out loud.
Kanye West,
okay. Could be. Okay, homosexuals, the LGBT community, Democrats, for sure. I think there are churches where that would be true. Say that again. Yeah, okay, gangbangers. Muslims. Yeah, the gay community, yes. Other cultures, absolutely. There's a decent amount of xenophobia in some of our churches.
For some Muslims, the Christians.
For some Muslims, the Christians. Okay. Yeah.
Poverty.
Yeah. Poor people, for sure.
Homeless.
Yeah, the homeless. Ex-cons. Yes. Okay. We came up with a pretty impressive list pretty quickly there. To our shame. Yeah? Okay. A couple quick evangelism notes looking at Philip here. Five little notes about evangelism from Philip. One, Philip was led by the Holy Spirit. He was told to go speak to this person. He was instructed where to go. So that's important. Two, he goes to where the eunuch is. He didn't try to bring him in to WEC week, right? He didn't say, oh, this guy Matt's speaking, you should come see him. He didn't try to bring him to a conference. He didn't wait for him at the temple. He went to where he was, to his place. Now, God directed him to that place, but what I'm saying is he went and found him, the lost one, sought him out. Three, notice that God's already at work in the life of the eunuch. I shared a story yesterday about that. I think we can trust that when we get into a spiritual conversation with someone, that we're not the first to speak. As Jesus said, we reap the benefit of work we did not do. Yeah. So that's something that Philip experiences here. Next, fourth, he begins the good news from the eunuch's questions. I don't understand what I'm reading. Can you explain it to me? We're going to look at that in a little more detail, but this is really important. When I have a really specific way I like to present the gospel, and I do, what can happen is that I don't learn the question, the pain, the hurt, the place, the confusion of the person I'm speaking to. And almost any place like that, that's what God has come to heal. And so there's a door to the gospel in that. So when someone asks me, did I kill my baby when I had an abortion? That's a horrific question, a horrible question. I hate when I get that question. Is there a place to start the good news there? Yeah. Oh, beautiful place to start the good news. Yes. When someone asked me, I was in North Carolina, and I was doing an outreach. I'm speaking to all these college students, and one of them comes up to me afterwards. I've been telling him, Jesus loves you. He wants to be in relationship with you. He comes up to me afterwards. He goes, hey, he said his name. Can I be in relationship with Jesus? I said, oh, yeah. Yeah, you can. Does he love me? Oh, yeah. For sure he does. And he smiles at me, and he pulls his shirt sleeve up to show me that he has a rainbow band on his hand. And he says, I'm the president of the LGBT Association on campus. So I ask you again, does God love me? Can I be in relationship with Jesus? And I started to laugh. I was like, yeah, of course. What a ridiculous question. Of course. And a look of terror came on his face because this was supposed to be his aha moment where he had me. And instead, suddenly he discovered that he was going to have to listen to how he could be in loving relationship with Jesus. Is that a good place to start the gospel? Yes. Yes. It's a beautiful place to start the gospel. Can I be gay and follow Jesus? Why did God allow this horrible thing to happen to me? Beautiful place to start the good news about Jesus. So, fifth thing, he doesn't hesitate to let the eunuch know what does prevent him from entrance into the kingdom. As they're going along, as he starts to explain things, the eunuch says to him, there's some water. What prevents me from being baptized? And Philip says, nothing. So long as you believe. So long as you believe. So he's not afraid to say that to him. So that's the fifth thing. So I want to look at this idea. It says he began with this passage in Isaiah. He began there to tell him the good news. Now this passage is amazing for sharing the gospel. We know in Isaiah it says this. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants, for his life was taken from the earth? Now, for us, this seems pretty straightforward, but you can imagine for someone who doesn't know what it's talking about that it might be confusing. Last year, I was in Florida, and there was a student who came up to me afterwards because he had accidentally come to this Christian conference and he was a non-believer. And I offered every week to do a, please come hang out with me tonight after the meeting if you accidentally came to spring break, you didn't know it was a Christian thing, and I'll explain to you what Christians believe and how to survive a Christian conference when you're not a Christian. And so I'd get 10 or 15 kids a week usually. This kid, we sit down and he says, okay, I don't know what's going on. I said, well, tell me what's going on. He goes, well, one, Christians are really scary. I said, what's so scary? He's like, the lyrics to your songs are really scary. I said, can you give me an example? He said, consume me from the inside out. It's like, so You want God to eat your guts. And then he said, also, why do you hate sheep? You're always like killing sheep, bathing in their blood. Like, what? And so I start to lay out to him, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. So this is so funny. This is a kid in the 21st century. He's 18 or 19 years old, and I'm explaining to him the Jewish sacrificial system. And that's where we start the gospel, which I did not think we usually started there anymore. But so I'm explaining this to him, how it works, the whole thing. And I said, and Jesus came so that no one has to die anymore. And he said, including the sheep? And I was like, yeah, including the sheep. And he goes, oh, that is good news. That is good news. This kid in the 21st century, to him, the good news is the Lamb of God has made it so the regular lambs are good. So it was pretty cool. Right? Why? Because we began with his questions, where he was, what he was asking. So what is good news to the eunuch? Well, I think what's interesting, if you look at this passage in Isaiah and you start to read the next several chapters and the scriptures around it, and remember, this is on a scroll. It's not in a book. It's not like, oh, we've reached the end of the chapter. Likely, they continued to read forward through what was written there. And there's some beautiful things about good news for the eunuch right around these passages. And I have to believe that Philip said, oh, this is a eunuch. We should read these things as well. And so get this. Philip reads, I'm guessing. Now, it doesn't say this in Scripture. So this is a little bit of a jump, right? Isaiah 54, 1 through 5. Hold on. I'm in the wrong place on my little fake book. Somebody have that? Can you read that? Isaiah 54, 1 through 5. Or I can. Oh, yeah, thank you.
Sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud. You have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of a bird who is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords and strengthen your stakes. For you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. Fear not, for you will not be ashamed. Be not confounded, for you will not be disgraced. For you will forget the shame of your youth, and the reproach of your widowhood you will remember no more. For your Maker is your husband, the Lord of hosts is his name, and the Holy One of Israel is your Redeemer, the God of the whole earth.
Thank you. Yeah, so the eunuch has been treated like a murderer of children because he'll never have descendants by the Jews. And Philip says, look what God says. Don't be afraid. You won't suffer shame. Don't fear disgrace. You won't be humiliated. Your Maker is your husband. The Lord Almighty is his name. It's beautiful. Isaiah 55:1, he says to him, all who are thirsty, come to the waters. All who are hungry, come and eat. And then Isaiah 56, 3 through 8. This is incredible. So just a short way down the scroll. Let no foreigner who is bound to the Lord say, the Lord will surely exclude me from his people. And let no eunuch complain, I am only a dry tree. I'll bear no fruit. I'll have no children. For this is what the Lord says. To the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose what pleases me and hold fast to my covenant, to them I will give within my temple, against what Scripture says elsewhere, that those who have been emasculated cannot enter into the presence of the Lord. To the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, I will give to them within my temple and its walls, a memorial and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that will endure forever. and foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, who keep the Sabbath without desecrating it, who hold fast to my covenant. These I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings, their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. The sovereign Lord declares, he who gathers the exiles of Israel, I will gather still others to them besides those already gathered. And what does the eunuch say? He hears all these things and he says to him, what prevents me? And what he means in that moment is very likely, literally, not, hey, I see some water, could we do this? But rather, I see some water, what's the catch? What is it about me that disqualifies me? I know I'm disqualified. I'm a foreigner. I'm castrated. I can't have children. I'm effeminate. So what is it? Go ahead. Let me know. You've said these beautiful things. That's why I've come to worship the Lord. But now tell me, what keeps me out of your community of faith? What prevents me? And Philip says, none of those things. No. If you believe the good story about Jesus, you can enter the water. Sometimes we have these things in our lives that we say, oh, that prevents me from coming to Jesus. Something we've done, something done to us. And I hear these all the time. People talk about abortion or abuse, orientation, experimentation, divorce, harming others, harming yourself, eating disorders, various sexual sins. What prevents me? Which of my defects, which of my actions, which of my desires prevents me from entering into this new life in the community of Christ followers? And Philip says again, nothing, nothing, no, none of that, nothing, nothing. So long as you believe. And baptism is this cleansing ritual, right? It's still practiced today by many devout Jews. It's still practiced in Israel. And some things that are different about the way it was practiced at this time than the way we practice it now, the first is that it was always done in living water, which means running water. It was never, if they could help it, done in dead water, still water. So it was always in living water. Fresh water. It was never done in the ocean. It was always done in fresh water. And it was always, nearly always, probably always, done naked, which is something we don't, in the evangelical church, encourage today. Many Orthodox churches still practice this. Devout Jews continue to practice this. The idea, right, was that you were being made clean. And by the way, the early church, this is how it was done. You were being made clean, and nothing should get between you and the cleansing water, not clothes, not earrings, not jewelry, because you're about to be reborn. And newborns, they don't come with those things. I mean, it's very rare. Very rare. Certain very holy children. Little tuxedos. So this is really interesting when you think about the Ethiopian eunuch, because everything that people would have said disqualified him from the family of faith would be on display when he went into the water. The color of his skin made it clear he was a foreigner. The fact that he had been emasculated was plain. There was no question for Philip of what disqualified, in the eyes of some others, this man from entering into the holy waters to be reborn. So the man believes, and they walk to the water's edge, and the eunuch removes all his clothes. And it's beautiful that the defects that kept him from the temple are now obvious to all. The eunuch reveals all his flaws, all his insecurities, and lets them be washed away in the cold of the living water, and it says he went away rejoicing when Philip disappeared afterwards. Because the Holy Spirit saw a man who thought he could not enter in to the community of faith. Had been told even by that community that he could not come in, even though he desperately wanted to do so. By the way, those who would say to any person, you can't come in to the community of faith, God makes it very clear. Jesus spoke to these people. He said, you stand outside the kingdom and prevent others from entering, and you yourself have not entered. If you find someone telling other people that they can't enter the kingdom of God, very likely they have not entered themselves. That's what Jesus tells us. So search your heart. Search our hearts. If we say those words, Jesus would say, that sounds like someone who's not a part of the kingdom. So the Holy Spirit saw this man who desperately wanted in, and the Spirit spoke to Philip and sent him on a journey to find the man where he was, alone, in the desert, and to bring him to the community of faith, to life, to the living water. And that's beautiful. And I wonder today, who's alone? Who's wandering the desert, seeking home, unsure if they can approach God in our community? I wonder who's been told by the gatekeepers, you can come no further toward God. I wonder who the Holy Spirit has chosen for us to find and to share the good news about Jesus. So you've been speaking to this man in the limousine, and the effeminate man in the limousine, he asks you, which of my defects prevents me? And you say, nothing. Nothing prevents you. There are so many people who would give you a list, an encyclopedia of barriers between you and God, but nothing prevents you so long as you believe. And you wade into the water. The shock of the cold takes your breath away, and you call for the man to join you. The police stand nearby with their arms folded. The limo driver stands near the limo, his shiny black cap in his hand, and the man comes and stands at the water's edge. He stares at the sunlight on the rippled surface for a long time, and then he shrugs out of his jacket. He places it on the ground. Then his tie, his carefully pressed shirt, his undershirt. He takes off his shoes, tucks the socks inside. He folds his slacks. He places them on the shirt. And when he is naked, you can see his scars. Every place where he was broken, every scar, every wound, every evil thing that has been done to him and by him and for him and through him. But those scars, they shine brighter than the chrome on the car. Brighter than the reflections on the water, brighter than the sun itself. Such things could no longer keep him from the Holy One. And you call out to him, do you believe? And he runs into the water, shouting over and over, I do, I do, I do. And he goes down into the water and he comes up whole, newly born. Newly alive, newly a son of God. And then the Spirit whisks you away. And the last thing you see is the water sparkling as it flies from his laughing face, his hands thrown up in the air as he dances from the water. Let's pray. Ah, Lord Jesus. Give us eyes to see the outsiders. Give us your vision that we might look at those who think there's no place for me in the community of God. It doesn't matter that I'm interested. It doesn't matter that I want to know. It doesn't matter that I want to worship. Let us see those people and let us be the ones to say to them, no, no, no. Nothing prevents you so long as you believe. Let us show them the truth of your good news from the place where they stand, to speak to them, to show that you say, even to the eunuch, something better even than being a son and daughter for you. And that we would walk with them to the water, that we would be with them as their guides, as their hosts, and then hopefully as their brothers and sisters. For all the people of the world, all the people we mentioned who might think maybe they're not welcome here, whether it be Muslims or the LGBT community, or foreigners, or people of other ethnicities, the poor, people of other political backgrounds, whoever they may be, Lord Jesus, let us see them first and foremost as those who you love, that they may know that they are loved by us, your representatives. Thank you, Jesus. We pray for today that you would bring into our lives some outsiders, that your holy angels and your Holy Spirit would direct us to them. Give us strength and power to speak in your name. Amen.